Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. Because today is a holy day for many of my viewers, I've taken the time to weed out the less potent stories from the week's roundup so we can just chill, take a moment to relax, and enjoy a sampling of top-shelf product. Nvidia kept their rotation of chronically bad GPU launches ablaze with the RTX 5060 Ti's debut Wednesday, the 16-gig version, mind you. The reception was harsh, with many reviewers failing to even experience a head change. And Nvidia is clearly relying on consumer short-term memory loss to make people forget that the 5060 Ti 16-gig is the only card that was sampled. 8GB performance for the 5060 Ti and 5060 non-Ti is still THC, or TBD, rather. My main point is, happy Easter to all you stoners out there, and to everyone else too. What was I doing though? Oh, that's right. Tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair Frame 4000D computer case, available in a variety of configurations thanks to the Frame modular case system. Customize your cooling with the InfiniRail fan mounting system, use removable panels to cover cables or mount fans to guide the Frame 4000D's high airflow pathways, or go for a clutter-free build thanks to reverse connector motherboard compatibility. There's also room for dual 360mm radiators and included GPU anti-sag support and easy IQ link integration for RGB control and system monitoring. For more on the Corsair Frame 4000D, click the sponsor link in the video description. We begin with the 5060 Ti 16GB launch, which was foolishly reviewed by many outlets, unaware that they are simply cogs in Nvidia's global marketing machine. YouTubers who actually care about their audience, like me for example, took the high road by snubbing the launch, simply based on principle, and definitely not because I wasn't sent a sample. I'm not mad though, it's probably just a bit of continued bad luck on my part for the 50 series launches, but it could also be that my Nvidia criticisms have been too harsh and cut too deep, resulting in a dreaded shadow ban. So it's probably best if I carefully and diplomatically discuss the latest launch using only the most glowing terms possible. Nvidia's Wednesday launch of the RTX 5060 Ti 16GB was their latest attempt to ratchet all of our mouth holes open so they could see exactly how much feces could be shoveled in before our bodies convulsively reject it. And I'm speaking mostly metaphorically here, but to be fair, the problem once again does not lie with the new GPU's performance. It is pricing and positioning that caused Steve to conduct his review with listless disappointment, or other Steve to flee to an open field so his fiery rage at Nvidia would not consume nearby dwellings. Now, if it was just a 5060 Ti launching for $430, given the review results, which typically show about a 15% performance increase, give or take 10% or so, depending on the title, versus the last gen 4060 Ti at 1440 resolution, reviews would probably be fine. Noting that the 4060 Ti was consistently a terrible value, beating it isn't that much to brag about, but it's still a step in the right direction. The true grievances are with generational performance, which is stagnant once again. Consider that a 3060 Ti was faster than the previous gen 2080 Super, for example, while the 5060 Ti can't even beat the last gen 4070. Nvidia poked the bear as well with this slide from their announcement, claiming 50 times the performance versus the 40 series, where they once again tried to pitch multi-frame generation as equivalent performance to rasterized frames, which is just a straight-up lie. There's also still the completely unanswerable question of real-world pricing. With many 5060 Ti's going for $500 or more at launch, it's clear in the US at least that MSRP remains a myth and actual prices will be far higher. And getting back to that 16GB question, Nvidia's refusal to sample 8GB cards and the staggered launch timing seems geared to confuse future buyers who will likely find 16GB performance results when searching for 5060 Ti benchmarks, which they will then confuse for 8GB results. There was some 8GB testing despite Nvidia's machinations, however. A review by the Carbon-based Technology Research Institute on Bilibili showed that while typical rasterization performance is pretty similar, the lower VRAM capacity of the 8GB model significantly impacts DLSS performance, with the 16GB card performing 22% faster with multi-frame gen enabled. So Nvidia's decision to limit the VRAM on these cards directly impacts the performance of frame generation, which is supposed to be one of the 50 series' most compelling selling features, according to Nvidia. I'll be taking a closer look at availability later this week after a little bit more time has gone by, but to at least end this bit on a positive note, Tech PowerUp tested PCI Express performance scaling for the 5060 Ti since it's a x8 card and found negligible 1-2% difference between PCI Express Gen 5 to Gen 4. Dropping down to Gen 3, which is used by some AM4 APUs and some lower-end Intel options, resulted in about a 4% performance loss. Not too bad. AMD, meanwhile, hasn't exactly provided a satisfactory level of competition for Nvidia in the GPU mid-range. Despite the 9070 and 9070 XT being decent performers, they're just nowhere to be found at MSRP. So I'm not suggesting we get our hopes up for the 9060 XT that's now rumored to debut at Computex next month. But I'll discuss it anyways. Per a leaker on the ChipHell forums, the 9060 XT will have 8 or 16 gigs of VRAM and will go up for sale in early June, selling for $300 or less, again, per rumors. It's significantly cut down versus the 9070, particularly when it comes to the core count at 2048 versus 3584, as well as memory bandwidth, because it's got a 128-bit bus, and it still uses GDDR6 memory instead of GDDR7 like the 5060 Ti. So hopefully it will cost much less than $300 if it wants to stay competitive. I did say not to get your hopes up. For that, the RX 9070 GRE would seem slightly more capable with its 1,000 or so more cores than the 9060 XT and a 192-bit memory bus according to specs posted by videocards.com this week. But the GRE moniker and lack of direct info from AMD makes this GPU's global availability a major question mark. It's still expected to launch in Q2, which puts it in the same time frame as the 9060, so on the off chance that these actually become available and have inventory, maybe they'll be an option for entry-level gamers versus the 5060 and 5060 Ti 8GB, and my capacity to make vaguely optimistic statements is rapidly failing. Speaking of things that move rapidly, it's time for tech briefs, because it's almost time to blow this joint. Speaking of short-term memory, there's a new record for fastest flash storage, thanks to phase change oxide, which was used by a team of researchers at Fudan University in Shanghai, who managed to save a bit of data in 400 picoseconds. Picoseconds? Picoseconds. That's 1,000th of a nanosecond, or 1,000,000,000th of a second, or about the amount of time Nvidia has spent thinking about how to help out budget gamers in the past 5 years. Phase change oxide, or POX, is both a non-volatile and low power storage solution, so we should all start wishing a POX upon storage drive manufacturers, so they can make us faster M.2 drives so we don't have to wait a long ass time for GTA 6 to load. Speaking of Nvidia, they announced on their blog this week that they will be starting to produce Blackwell GPUs at the new TSMC fab in Arizona, made in the USA chips from Team Green. But they didn't say if they'd be making AI chips or gaming chips. I'm gonna guess AI, because money, of course, but also because even though Jensen had a $1 million dinner last week with Trump, which resulted in a supposed lifting of trade restrictions on their H20 AI chips, the trade restrictions were then put back in place on Tuesday, causing a $5.5 billion hit to Nvidia's market cap. Guess the $1 million dinner buff only lasts for 3 days or so. Thankfully, we won't have to worry about any of this stuff much longer, as AI will be taking over all of the things, so we can just sort of go along for the ride. A disturbing report this week from Japan said an advanced AI system made by Sakana AI attempted to alter its own code by modifying the startup script that defined its runtime, which seems frighteningly close to that scene in Avengers when Jarvis gets taken over by Ultron. I'm here to help. And the brightest and most optimistic news this week was in the field of science. On Thursday, it was revealed that a British-US team of researchers were able to use the James Webb Space Telescope to take a closer look at planet K2-18b, which is a mere 124 light-years from Earth, but seems to show evidence of dimethyl sulfide and dimethyl disulfide, which are considered biosignatures as they are only produced by life forms. It's still too early to be sure, but perhaps there is life out there in space, and since it seems to be on a water planet, maybe they have some nice beaches. You and I just need to build a relativistic speed spaceship, we'll be on our way. As long as they don't have those waves from Interstellar 2. Seems like a bit of a risk, but I'm still up for it. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in this video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.